passed away, and I'm going to see if we can get that posted to the, at least the obituary or the announcement posted to the website. As you know, during this time, it is a time where it's a private ceremony. Every funeral now basically is a graveside funeral. So just continue to pray for them as well. Good to see Sister Board, Sister Sheila, Sister Bembry. Good to see you all. God bless you. Sister Campbell, Sister LeBlanc, good to see you. Sister Levi, good to see you as well. Reverend Major, good to see you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. If you've got any announcements, please go ahead and send them to us and I can look at them. There is one other additional announcement I want to make sure that you're aware of, that Sister Aisha Smith was actually part of had some tornado damage in her neighborhood around her house. She nor the kids were hurt, but there was a lot of damage around the house considering trees down, limbs down. So continue to pray for her as well. Brother LeBlanc, Sister Collins, Leader, good to see you. Carolinko, good to see you, my friend. All right, y'all, let's get started tonight. We're about 7 minutes after, and I promise you it won't be before you too terribly long, but something I do want to just speak to you a few minutes about to hopefully help you to understand a little bit about this particular passage of Scripture that we have read, seen about several times. We've heard about it over and over again. Good to see you, Deacon Price. Good to see you. You and Sister Price praying for you too as well. If you will, get your Bibles and go with me to John chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Very familiar passage of Scripture. Today I had the opportunity of looking at about 3 or 4 different midday Bible studies, as well as a couple that started at 6, and just perusing to try to see. And one of the things that I saw was that a lot of people are taking topical Bible studies and then going through various scriptures and moving through it, which is good. It's a little difficult for me, given, as you know, those who've been a part of our Bible study, we like to take a subject and walk through that subject. But if you will, one of the things I did notice in two of the ones that I saw today, that they don't necessarily, I'm not going to say weren't scripturally based, but they did a lot of talking about different things, not necessarily about the Scripture. And I want to make sure that during this particular lesson, especially, that you notice that what we're talking about comes directly from the Bible. It helps us to understand how the Bible is applicable to us, not only during that time in which it was written and during the time in which people were making the canon or making the books, or putting the books together, the various letters together to make the Bible, but how it's applicable to us even today. The Word of God is applicable to the point to where it was good enough, like the older folk would say, for my dear old mother, and it's good enough for me. We've got to make sure that when we're looking that we have the ability to realize exactly what the Scripture is saying to those people, what the audience was at that time, and how we can apply that to us today. So if you will, go with me to St. John chapter 3, verse 1 through 8. Very familiar passage. And it says, "And there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And the same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do the miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say again, ye must be born again." And I just want to look at that particular verse for just those particular verses for just a second. I want to talk about having a relationship with the Spirit, or knowing exactly what it is Nicodemus was looking for, what he needed. Now, we've read the scripture, John 3:1-8, and the Holy Spirit plays a very important role in our lives in the spiritual birth of a man. Transformation, Jesus calls, he calls it being born again. Let's see if you will. We find here that Nicodemus is a ruler of the Jews. He's a devout man. As a matter of fact, when I looked up Nicodemus today, I found out that he was a member of the Sanhedrin Council, which we'd all heard before, but what exactly does that mean? Being a member of the Sanhedrin Council meant that he was a learned man. He was a man who was disciplined by the law. He knew the law being the Lord, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. He was a man who understood those books. He had gone through various classes to be able to show that he had a devout knowledge of what it is God was saying for and to his people. Now, one thing I want to make sure that you understand, we've heard the term Sanhedrin before. But what exactly is the Sanhedrin Council, and how important was it? Well, the Sanhedrin Council was an assembly of men that was either 23 or 71 men. Now, 23 men, during that particular time, the only time that you could have a city or a township was you had to have at least 23 men who understood the word or the law of the Bible. They didn't call it the Bible at that time. It would have been the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, or the Talmud, or possibly even other writings that dealt with the Old Testament scriptures. So these 23 men had to have a working knowledge of what God's word was. But then that was called the Lesser Sanhedrin Council. And then there was the Greater Sanhedrin Council. And the Greater Sanhedrin Council would have been very similar to what we would call the Supreme Court. Now, the men who were part of the township had the opportunity to be a part of the 71. But it was an elected official somewhat. So just because you were a part of the Sanhedrin at your local town did not mean that you were part of the Supreme Court, as it would be for the Sanhedrin Council of the Greater. So these were the judges of the city. They were the ones who who took care of all the legal matters, all the religious matters. Those things had to come before them. So in order to be a part of the Sanhedrin Council, if you were a part of the Sanhedrin Council, that meant that you were somebody in society. It would somewhat be similar today to a commission, or it would be somewhat to the city council, so to say. There was also, once again, the Sanhedrin Council, the Greater or the Lesser. And I couldn't find exactly which one Nicodemus was a part of. We know that he was a part of the Sanhedrin Council, but was he a part of the great? I wasn't exactly sure. Even in looking at Josephus, who was a Jewish historian, who was a Jewish writer during that time, he mentions Nicodemus, but he does not mention whether or not he was in the greater Sanhedrin Council. In the midst of that, I need you to understand that Nicodemus was a good man, though. Nicodemus also had an apocryphal book. An apocrypha is, some refer to those as the lost books of the Bible, but the apocrypha means that it's a book that was not accepted into the canon. Now, I want you to understand that there were a lot of people who wrote different accounts of Jesus. There were people who wrote their personal accounts. There were people who had heard accounts from other people and decided to write that as a letter or as a book. But we call all books that are not in our Old or New Testament, or the New Testament, we call them apocrypha. Once again, they're referred to as the lost books of the Bible. Apocrypha could mean false accounts. I can't say that they were false accounts. I can't say that they're lost books of the Bible, considering our Catholic brothers and sisters do have a couple of those books in their Bible. But what I can say is there was a measure, there was a standard that was looked upon from the Council of Jemima, in 90, where they decided which books would be a part of the New Testament canon. The King James Version is what we believe. Now, there are many who would say, hey, those men who decided that weren't godly, the standard may not have been to their standard. They decided that they wanted their friend's book in it. You know, all of those things can come into play. But I will say this, even in the midst of all of that, God was in the midst of it. And God allowed what books he wanted to be allowed into the Bible. So let us not argue, and I don't want to go into a theological debate by any means, but we can't argue God's plan. God allowed the books that he wanted into this canon, into the New Testament canon. And thus, the book of Nicodemus, the Gospel of Nicodemus is what that apocryphal book is called, is not one of those books. Now, when you look at Nicodemus as a person, he was a good man, y'all. He was a just man. He was highly religious. He had great means, which means that he had some wealth behind him. He was a man of good moral conduct. He was a man who had, he was a friend to many people. He was a man who had great means. What I mean by that is he was influential. He was influential, great man. He was well-liked. He would be the epitome of what one would think would be a person who's on the road to heaven. And even though Nicodemus was a good person, even though he was morally right, he was still in need of something. Yes, yes, even though he had what a society or the Jews would have thought would have been the great opportunity to be a great man, a leader among the county, among the state, among the citizens, he still was in lack of something. He lacked the Holy Spirit in his life. And he realized this. He realized this. And I just want to say, my brothers and sisters, that going to church and living a morally good life is good. Having a life that's an exemplar to every other Christian is good. But you've got to be born again. And Nicodemus realizes. He realizes this. We find here that Nicodemus' encounter with Jesus. This encounter is not found in the other three Gospels or the Synoptic Gospels. This encounter is only found recorded in the book of John. And it says here, if we read verses 1, 2, 3 right quick, it says, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. He was a ruler of the Jews. And the same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher that's come from God. For no man can do the miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Now, if you will, who was Nicodemus? Once again, he was a devout man of God. And what was his level of scripture like? Well, the Bible tells us in verse 1 that he was a ruler among the Jews. In order to be a ruler, he had to be a man who was well-versed with the Bible, well-versed with the Old Testament, so to say. And if you look down at verse number 10, it says here that he was a master of Israel and that he knew much of the scripture. So he knew the scripture. He knew what the Old Testament word said. He knew it. He was a great man. But here it is. The Bible says that he came to Jesus by night. Now, what do you suppose that his understanding of Jesus was? Well, first thing, notice he refers to Jesus as a great teacher. He calls him rabbi. This is a collegial term, a respectful greeting. Rather than respond to Nicodemus' greeting, Jesus challenges him with teaching. Jesus, my brothers and sisters, knew that he had come here asking and seeking a question. So he says here, Rabbi, we know that thou art a man come from God. Now notice here, watch this. He says here, we know. All of us recognize that Jesus was not just an ordinary teacher, but he was someone that was sent by God. Look what it says. He says here, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. Now, who is the we know? You know, it's about like them they say. You know, they say, they. There are a lot of people who have lost some good husbands behind they said, and there's some people who lost some wives behind they say, and you didn't finish school because of what they say, and you did some things because of what they said not to do. But he says, we know that thou art a great teacher. Now, when Nicodemus says this, he was referring to the people or his cohorts. Watch this. Nicodemus was speaking on behalf of his colleagues, saying the words out loud that had been whispered by many. Look at this. Look at this. Nicodemus says, we know. We've been talking about you, Jesus. We've heard and we've seen the miracles and the wonders that you've done. And we know that you are a man that has come from God. You got to be a teacher that's come from God. For no man can do the things that you do. Look at this. Jesus deliberately uses a word. Now, watch this. No, I'm sorry. The Jews, I need you to understand, could not and would not argue the fact that Jesus had a great understanding of the law. Let's be perfectly honest. They knew that Jesus knew the law. They remember, Jesus to them must have been a kid prodigy of some sort. If you remember, when he was 12 years old, they had gone to the feast. And when they got there, they had stayed there and they'd work. And as his family, Mary and Joseph and his kindred, were going back, Jesus was not among the crowd. So they go back and they look for Jesus. They said, where is Jesus? They go back and they look to where they thought Jesus, a 12-year-old boy, would have been. They looked at the playground. They looked at the museum. They went and found all the 12-year-old girls. I don't know. They went and did all these things that they could. But then they decided to go look for Jesus in the synagogue. And there Jesus was talking, teaching, and preaching with the lawyers and the doctors. And he says to them, I must be about my father's business. The Jews could not argue the fact that Jesus understood and knew the law. The Jews could not and would not argue the fact that Jesus had performed the miracles. Look what he says. He says, for we know that thou art a teacher from God, for no man can do the miracles that you do. Look at this. They knew. Look, they had not had any miracles performed in their presence since the Old Testament prophets. Y'all, watch this. The prophets of old had performed miracles, and they knew all the miracles. They remembered the miracles that Moses had performed. And just to name two, water, Moses had turned water, taken mortar from the rock, and the fire at Taberah. And they knew about the miracles of Joshua, where Joshua marched around the walls of Jericho, and the walls fell down. And they knew about the miracle where Joshua had prayed, and God allowed the moon and the sun to stand still. They knew the miracles of Samuel, how God had sent rain and thunder in the midst of nothing. They knew about Elijah and Elijah, the miracles were reviving the widow of Zarephath's son, and the widow's oil and meal never running out. And they knew about Naaman being cured, being baptized in the muddy Jordan River. They knew about Isaiah, how Isaiah had gone and declared that Hezekiah was going to get ready to die, but God had worked a miracle through the hands of Isaiah, through the voice of Isaiah, to be able to declare that Hezekiah would live. They knew the miracle about Daniel, how Daniel had slept in the lion's den, and how Daniel and the Hebrew boys had been in the fiery furnace, but yet God had sustained them in the midst of that. They knew all of the miracles of the Old Testament, and here it is now, in their presence, they are seeing great miracles being performed. What, can you imagine, I can't imagine that, but can you imagine being there and hearing how over in the next town, the man who had been sick all of his life is being healed, and hearing about a woman, I'll give her a name, Aunt Sally, they had been sick for 38 years, and folk wouldn't even go around her because she had an issue of blood, but they knew that Aunt Sally had been sick all those years and had that issue of blood, but one day she touched the hem of Jesus' garment, and Sally now was able. Aunt Sally was able to be around other people. They'd seen people being healed. You're looking at people who had seen and had seen Lazarus die one time and gotten up from the grave. They'd seen lame folk laying there, and here it is now. This man, Jesus the Christ, is there, and he's in the midst of them. And here it is. Nicodemus now has the opportunity to be able to talk to him. He says, Jesus, we know that thou art a man sent from God, because can't nobody do what you do. And I need to tell you, can't nobody do what Jesus does. The songwriter said, I searched all over and I couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low and still couldn't find nobody. Can I tell you, even in the midst of this, Jesus can still do what only Jesus can do. I know Dr. Fauci, I believe is his name, is advising the president. I know the president in his mind has done great things by giving us a stimulus payment. And I know that the mayors and the governors of towns are trying to do great things. The doctors are doing great things. And I've even seen on here lately in hospitals that heroes are working here because they are working and helping to save those that are sick. But can I tell you, even all that they have done, and it's good, and I'm not minimizing what they've done, but they cannot do what Jesus was able to do. Here it is. Here it is. They said, Jesus, we come to you, Rabbi, great teacher, we come to you because we know that no man can do what you've done. And I need to know, Jesus, I got a question. Now look, notice he refers to him as Rabbi. Jesus deliberately uses a question. Notice Jesus didn't even allow him to ask his question. The Bible says Jesus answered and said unto him. That's one thing I like about Jesus. You don't have to say a word. All you've got to do is think it. Have your heart to say it. And Jesus recognizes the hearts and the thoughts and the mind even before you say it. Now look here. Jesus says unto them, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, what does that mean? What does that mean? Jesus deliberately here uses an ambiguous word. The word that he uses here for nothing, which is translated again or from above. And this is a Greek word which has, watch this, no comparable meaning in either the Hebrew, the Aramaic, or even the English language. So in other words, I can't say that Jesus made this word up, but it was enough of a word. It was enough of a word to where Nicodemus had a clue what it was that he was talking about. Some would call it, and I'm not an English teacher, but I believe the word is colloquialism, where you can say a word to where people have a meaning in this general vicinity. And here it is, Jesus uses this word. Now watch this. Nicodemus thought the word literally meant, again, for a Jew to see the kingdom of God meant participating in the kingdom at the end of age or eternal life. And Jesus insisted that no one could see the kingdom without the spiritual rebirth. Because Nicodemus began the conversation by saying, we know, some scholars believe that Jesus, that they've been talking about Jesus, and Jesus uses this ambiguous word for Nicodemus. Now here, I want you to understand, Nicodemus knew of Jesus through his signs. Now, can I tell you this? Signs were generally thought to be an indication of God's presence. So, once again, when Jesus answered the question, he said unto him, Nicodemus is thinking that Jesus knows all, he knew Jesus because of the signs, but here, Jesus reveals something greater than just signs. Nicodemus, I know your thoughts before you even ask them. Wow. How great is that? You know, if Buddha could claim that, we wouldn't have, the Buddhists wouldn't have to pick him up and carry him to the next room to be able to ask them what they needed to do. Wow. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? If Confucius realized that, Confucius would not have eaten the spoiled meat from his followers. Wow. If David Koresh had realized that, he should have known. He would have realized that the FBI and NSB and all those others were going to be there to come down on them there in Waco, Texas. But here, Jesus is able to answer the question. Now watch, Jesus uses this ambiguous question, ambiguous answer, by saying, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now, the Jews had a great respect for Jesus, of him being a prophet and a teacher and a preacher. And the word not accepted the fact that Jesus was God, but they couldn't accept the fact that Jesus was God's only son. Now, look at this. Jesus says, verily I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, why could the Jews not accept Jesus, if you will? Let me just stick a pin right there. First, I need you to understand that their father had promised the Messiah, but Jesus simply didn't fit the bill. He didn't look the part. And you know, isn't that amazing? Sometimes we don't think people fit the part or look the part or fit the bill, but we never know what God has inside. I thank God that God does not judge the outside, but the inside of a man. Watch this. The Jews, would say that Jesus was not a direct descendant of David. You've got to remember that it was through Jesus's mother that he was born as a descendant of David. In order for Jesus to have been, why would I say his mother? Because Jesus had no earthly father. I saw your question, Brother Lowe. He was a direct descendant through Mary, and you've got to remember that women of that time did not necessarily share the bloodline. They were considered property. Watch this. They didn't accept Jesus because he was born to an unwedded mother. Yeah, He was a human who claimed to be a deity and a God. And here, I need you to understand. Now watch this. Jesus, the Jews could not or would not accept the fact that a man, a human being, would call himself a deity. Now, brothers and sisters, notice here. Watch also, while Jesus is answering the question, I want you to notice too that Nicodemus comes to Jesus by night. Now, some may say, why did he come to him by night? Well, this could have been because he was fearful of what others would say about him. You know, that's why some of us, some of our family members won't come to Christ, won't come to church, because they're concerned about what we're going to say about him. But it doesn't matter what we say or how we feel. It only matters how Jesus feels. This could have been the case because he wanted an uninterrupted conversation with Jesus. And he was curious. Can you imagine that when Nicodemus would have come or people being there at Jesus, there were people all around Jesus every minute of the day trying to vying for his attention. And here it is, Nicodemus decided, well, hey, if I go at night, maybe I can have Jesus' attention all by myself. This could be also because he was fearful of what the Pharisees and the Sadducees would have to say. You got to remember the Pharisees were the religious people, and the Sadducees were the ones who were rulers at that time who had lots and lots of money. Now here, once again, he has a question. He says, he comes, and before he's able to answer his question, Jesus answered and said to him, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Rather than to respond to Jesus' greeting, Jesus challenges him with the teaching. Jesus deliberately uses this word to try to get Nicodemus to think about it. Look at verse 4:3. Jesus says, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again. Now, if a man, now Nicodemus would have known, once again, he would have known that a man had to be born of a natural cause. But here it is, Jesus says again, look at Nicodemus in verse 4. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the womb, enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Now, I want you to understand that this, that when Jesus says, when Nicodemus says, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb? He was talking about the natural birth. Now watch this. Jesus says in verse 5, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Let's look at Jesus' response. Jesus says of the water. Born of the water was Jesus' way of saying the natural birth. Now we all know, and I'm not a doctor by any means, but I do know that babies live inside of a bag that's filled with water. And this water, once the baby is born, they will go in and they break the water, so to say, and the baby is birthed from this water. So when Jesus says, except a man be born of the water, which means that he has to physically be born here on the earth, but then by the placenta bursting, he says, and of the Spirit. Now, what is it that Jesus will be talking about as it relates to the Spirit? He's talking about the Holy Spirit. My brothers and sisters, if you have not had a Holy Spirit at birth, I will check my salvation. I know you're saying, well, Pastor, I've been going to church all my life. Yeah, going to church is good. Nicodemus had gone to church all his life. Yes, learning the Bible is good. Nicodemus had learned the Bible. Nicodemus could probably recite the first five books verbatim, simply because of who he was. He was a Jewish ruler. He had studied the word. And so it is with us. But we must be born of the water and of the Spirit. We must have the Holy Spirit within our lives. Now, I begin to think about this. Watch this. With what did Nicodemus quite naturally confuse spiritual birth? Nicodemus confused the spiritual birth with the natural birth. And in what ways did the physical birth process, being born the first time, compare with the spirit? So this is what I want to spend another 5 minutes on, and then I'll let you go. I know, I don't know exactly what you're doing, but let's think about for just a second. How many individuals are involved in the a natural birth or a physical birth? How many individuals are involved? And just interactively, while you've got your family sitting right there with you or co-workers or something, just ask them, how many people would be involved in a physical birth? Well, I'm getting to think about it. Well, there's probably the mother, not probably, the mother has to be there. Men can't birth children. Typically, there's a doctor or a midwife of some sort, birthing coach. So definitely the mother, I'd say probably a doctor or a birthing coach or something. And nowadays, if you're blessed, and I know now during COVID times, COVID-19 times, fathers aren't invited into the birthing room anymore, at least not now. They can't be in the room right now. But I can remember with all of my children, all of our children, I was in the room with them, and I was there to and be able to enjoy that experience. Watch this. Note that the father does not necessarily have to be involved in the physical birth. They have babies all day long. The father ain't there. But notice when it comes to the spiritual birth. Who has to be present for the spiritual birth? The person who needs to be born again, and the father. And here it is, my brothers and sisters. There are some similarities between the physical birth and the spiritual birth. But can I tell you, you can be born again right here sitting in your den with your feet kicked up under the table. You can be born again. You can have your spiritual birth right now. I like what you said, Sister Vita, having a relationship as opposed to having a ritual. You're absolutely right. Now look at this. How visible are the early stages of development? And this is where I'm closing. Physical birth, when we physically are born, you have to do everything for that baby. You have to feed them with milk. You have to care for them. He has to be taught. He or she has to be taught everything that needs to be taught. Again, has to learn how to walk. Got to learn how to do and what not to do. And that's so great. And when we have the spiritual birth, the same thing happens to us, y'all. We have to learn. We have to eat from milk. We can't understand Christology. We can't understand exegeting of words and a dogma of Christianity and the theological truths, arguing points as to what Keisha and I were talking the other day, and we were talking about verse. What were we talking about? I can't remember. We were talking just yesterday about I can't even remember, but it was something. And even in the car, I was talking to her and said, "Hey, it's not even something we have to be concerned about because it's not necessarily integral to our faith." And God, for the life of me, I can't remember what it was we were talking about. But with the spiritual birth, we have to care for those people. We've got to help them. And even in times like this where they can't get to the church, where they can't get to Bible study, we've got to be that spiritual advisor to them to be able to help them. We've got to burp them. We've got to chew up food sometimes, take it out of our mouth, and be able to give it to them. And so it is. We must do those things. My brothers and sisters, he says, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Listen, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, the Bible says right here, you can't enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is carnal. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spiritual. Can I tell you, my brothers and sisters? Oh, we were talking about, thank you, Keisha, we were talking about the creation of woman. I knew she was going to put it in here. The creation of woman, whether woman was created at the same time that Adam was created or not. And that's another Bible study lesson. We'll talk about that one shortly. But he says, except we be born again, we cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. And we must have the Spirit. So what happens when we have been birthed through this spiritual birth? Well, when we birth through a physical birth, and children are taught, and we teach them, we nurture them, we help them to become, we shape them and mold them to become fine, productive young men and women of society. Well, the same thing happens with us spiritually. We must nurture them. We must put our hands on them to help them, to cultivate them, to become fine men and women of mature faith in Christianity. I like the story of Nicodemus, and the reason I like the story of Nicodemus is because Nicodemus, there's a Nicodemus inside of all of us. Yeah, some of us truly are good individuals, but we need to have the Holy Spirit in our lives. I pray that this message has been a blessing to you. I pray that you allow the Spirit to continue to work in your life. I pray that you allow the Spirit to continue to be fed. Yeah, see, you can't go all week long without eating and naturally, physically, and expect to be fit and expect to be in good shape. So it is with us spiritually. You can't go all week long without eating of the Word of God, feasting on the Word of God, and expect to be fit and mature and have your body to perform the way that it should perform. God bless you. Thank God for seeing you once again. Good to see you, Sister Kogel. So glad to see you. Sister Rhonda Hawkins, Leah, good to see you. Kimberly, Sister Hubbard, good to see you. Vita, good to see y'all. I love you, and I'm going to be honest, I can't wait to get back to church again.
Yes.
I cannot wait to get back. Darius, good to see you, Brother Hubbard. Pastor Bateman, good to see you. I can't wait, Sister Walker, it's good to see you. I can't wait till we can fellowship again. Oh, what a blessing. I remember seeing my grandmother years ago. They used to have a little country church down in Louisville called Walden Grove, where they would sing a song, "Just One More Time, Glad to Be in the Number, One More Time." And I can remember seeing my grandma and her first cousins them crying and shouting over that song. And I'm going to tell you, when we get back in the number one more time, I can imagine there will be some of us shouting over that. Brother Smith, good to see you. Leader, good to see you again. Continue to pray for us as I pray for you. I'm going to close with a word of prayer, if that's all right. I'm looking to see if there are any announcements. If you'll just text me, that is good. Y'all continue to pray for our elderly that are here in this land and country. I talked to Sister Laurie Reese earlier today. And her mother has been admitted into the hospital. They've got her there for observations and possibly COVID, but pray for her. Pray that God is still in the midst and God does what he needs to do. Sister Campbell, little Sister Campbell, Jamelda, and Sister Patrice, good to see you. I'll tell my deacon I said hello. And as we pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you tonight for your grace, your mercy, and your awesome power. We thank you for just being our God. We thank you, God, for bringing us out of darkness and bringing us into the marvelous light. God, we thank you, Lord, that Nicodemus came to you by night, asking what he must do to be saved. And you told him that he must be born of the water and of the Spirit. You told him, marvel not, he must be born again. And help us, God, to be born again, not just of the water, not of the natural birth. But Lord, help us to be born again of your Holy Spirit. Help us, O God, to accept what your Spirit is doing in our lives and in our hearts. And God, we ask right now that you cultivate us, clean out what's not right in us, create in us a new heart, Lord. If you see anything in us that's not right, that's unworthy, that's unholy, wash it out of us, Lord. Clean us, God. Help us, O God. It's in times like this, O God, we ask, Lord, that we need your holy presence. God, we ask right now that you continue to bless our members, to bless our friends and our family. God, look upon them right now as they're holding their phones in their hands, looking at their iPads or their tablets, or either looking at us on YouTube, God. God, we ask that you go into their house and just touch them right now. God, let your Holy Presence and Holy Spirit move in the midst. Oh, God, we thank you, Lord, that you are God that's not just centered at a church, at a building someplace, but you're everywhere at the same time. You're omnipresent. We thank you, God. I know we take it for granted and we don't always appreciate that, God, but we thank you, God, that we don't have to assemble at a particular place, God, to know that we've been in your presence. Your presence is ever with us. God, we ask right now that you bless the children that are out of school. Bless those teachers, God, we ask that you look upon those that are unemployed right now, God, those that are standing in need of financial blessings, God. Lord, we ask that you move in the midst of not just this country, but throughout the whole world. God, I ask right now that if you will, God, to look upon the leaders of this country. Lead them, oh God.
Yes.
Lord, we ask right now, Lord, that you just put your hands on the congressmen, the president, the senators, God, and just let them know, God, that they don't have just themselves to answer for, but a nation of people, but then they've got to answer to you. God, I ask right now for anyone who's sitting here today, oh God, who needs to accept your Holy Spirit. God, I ask right now that you prick their hearts, help them to understand that they must repent of their sins and accept you into their life. And God, they can be reborn again. God, we thank you right now. God, we praise you. We'd be so careful to give your name the honor, the glory, and the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. One last thing. Y'all, I thought about this and writing lesson today and going through this, you know, still praying for the church concerning, you know, people being scattered, for lack of a better word, only having a virtual lessons, virtual church, so to say. I said, Lord, you know, we really miss seeing people, putting my hands on people to be able to see exactly how they're doing, what they're doing in their lives and stuff. And God spoke to me. He said, you know, it's kind of similar to when a parent has a child and that child walks out to go to college or moves out on their own. You've taught them what they need to know and how to survive. And now you just got to stand back and watch them walk and do what you have taught them to do. So God is still speaking to me concerning you, and I've just got to watch you. I got to watch you do your faith walk, y'all. I got to watch you do your faith walk. Pray for us and praying for you. God, I love you. God loves you. And I see Sister Boyd says she loves you too. First family loves y'all. As you know, this third Sunday, we would have been going to a Good Shepherd for the church anniversary. We're not going to Good Shepherd for the church anniversary. Amen. Just continue to pray for them as well. Pastor Moore called me and said that we'll reschedule it sometime later on in the year. God bless. Love you. Talk to you later. Thank you.